Thank you, Mort, and thank you, Ushmita, for this beautiful presentation. It was a wonderful introduction to Riten Majumdar's practice. And thank you to Mort, Tara, and Ushmita for inviting me to this seminar. I have really learned many new things about Riten's practice, thanks to both your lecture presentation and to the show. And it was a marvelous exhibition on this pioneering artist-designer, Riten Majumdar. And it was truly great to encounter Riten's experimentation in painting, sculpture, textile, and furniture design. He had an incredible grasp over materials, techniques, formats, and above all, scale. From designing a pillow cover to risking failure on gigantic mobile sculptures for an expo, he was not afraid to experiment. A dazzling polymath, his imagination was primarily nourished by his mentors in Shantiniketan, as Ushmita has already introduced that aspect to us. So he was influenced by Rabindranath Tagore, Binod Bihari Mukherjee, Ramkin Kerbej. We also see the influence of Joseph and Annie Albers, Neo-Tantric Art, Robert Motherwell, and Mondrian in his paintings and design work. In fact, even of Gottlieb, actually. Majumdar's practice was shaped by a confident globalism. It is clear from his practice that he was deeply influenced by Tagore's desire for a planetary exchange, which eschewed a narrow nationalist or regional chauvinism, as well as by Nehru's expansive non-aligned position during the Cold War period. I was delighted when I heard about the Chatterjee and Lal project. It aligns with my own research on the prehistory of new media art in India, which I have been engaged for many years. So these are just some of the images from this marvelous, marvelous show. And now I move on to my show, Counter Canon, Counter Culture, Alternative Histories of Indian Art, which opened on 15 December 2019 at the Serendipity Arts Festival. And the reason why I'm showing you just a very few excerpts from my show is because the narrative of counter-canon counterculture intersects with Ushmita's show. And of course, Riten Majumdar was also a part of CCC. And I'll just try and extend the narrative a little bit. So we will actually learn more, a little bit about Riten Majumdar, but also Riten Majumdar in connection with Jasbir and Rosemary Sachdev, and Riten Majumdar's practice in parallel with another artist-designer like Dashrath Patel. I'm just trying to extend this narrative so that we then don't only have a monographic perspective only on a single artist. Because while we are reclaiming all these lost histories, it's always very important to have the largest possible picture in mind. Otherwise, then we start glorifying or putting a particular artist on the pedestal, and we forget about the larger social, economic, and technological context from which these practices emerge. So counter-canon counterculture had 40 artistic positions from the fields of photography, film, music, design, and activism. It also included the work of Riten Majumdar, as I said, and it presented a constellation of dynamic artistic practices in India from the late 40s onwards, which had little or nothing to do with the dominant narrative of Indian art history, a narrative that is confined to a sequence of avant-garde aspirations and institutional shifts. By contrast, CCC resurrects and creates a dynamic montage of the unknown or unrecognized histories of experimentation and collaboration in photography, film, music, and transmedia experiences. To accomplish this, CCC deliberately looks in the wrong places at magic shows. As you can see, you have PC Sarkar on the screen, trade fairs. This is from Dashrath Patel's installation at the Montreal Fair in 1967. This is from Expo 70 at Osaka. These are Krishan Khanna's murals from the pavilion. And the Osaka 70 Indian Pavilion was designed by Jasbir and Rosemary Sachdev, Jasbir Sachdev and Rosemary Eagleston. And this is Jasbir Sachdev in his home in Delhi. The show also looks at activist collectives like Dashrath Patel and Sheba Chachi. I think I'm skipping a slide. This is Shiva Chachi's work from Om Swaha, the feminist play, which was based on an anti-dowry campaign in the early 1980s. In CCC, I was also looking at interdisciplinary workshops and cultural centers. So for example, the Vision Exchange workshop that was led by Akbar Padamsi, along with filmmakers like Mani Kaul, Kumar Shahani, and the cinematographer K.K. Mahajan, and artists like Geef Patel, and also photographers like Bhupendra Karya and others. And in this particular slide, actually, what I was also doing is that because a lot of these histories, especially of late modernism, when we are reclaiming these histories, many of these histories are dominated by male artists. So the idea was to also extend, how we look at the Vision Exchange workshop, because apart from Nalini Malani, in the main, they were basically all male practitioners. And so what I did was that apart from showing Syzygy and showing archival documentation from the Vision Exchange workshop, I just tried to, in a kind of poetic manner, extend the narrative. So you have Nasreen Mohammadi's photographs, of the roadway, the highway, architectural detail, and then you have this detail from Fatehpur Sikri, and I place it next to two of the animated stills from Syzygy. And so you have a very different kind of narrative which is now being produced. Syzygy, which is a film based on animated drawings that Akbar Padamsi devised, and Nasreen Mohammadi working parallelly on these very minimalist photographs, which of course she never wanted to show when she was alive. These were shown, her photographs, her notebooks were all shown after she passed away. So at different points in the exhibition, you have these, either a synergy of different perspectives, or you have a counterpoint, or you have parallel narratives moving, together. And this is actually a still from Kalpana, Uday Shankar's Kalpana. This is a still from, these are pages from Dayanita Singh's book, which is on Zakir Hussain, which she made as a student at NID. And these are basically, these pages actually tell you about all the decisions that she made while making this book. And importantly, she wasn't doing a course on book design, but she decided that she would actually, bring in her interest in photography and book design together. And that's how, through that intersection of book design and photography, she made a book which was very different from the normal coffee table books that you would have found at that time. And since this show is all about experiment, failure, stillbirth, often you'd find annotations, marginalia, miscellany, things scratched out, things written over. This is a film by Kiran David, which has not really been shown in many years, actually, now. And even when it was shown to small groups of people. And this is called Junk. It's from 1986. There's an incredible narrative related even to this particular film. But because this lecture is not primarily about CCC, I will move on. And maybe I'll do a separate lecture on this subject. Here we have Ram Rahman and Neil Chattopadhyay, and these are images from their archives. You have Neil Chattopadhyay, who was actually one of the lead guitarists of the legendary band called Atomic Forest, and I also found his drawings when I met him in Goa. So we've put up reproductions of his drawings. There's an archival record of all his performances. And Ram also, from the 70s and then the 80s, he carries forward the countercultural impulse. So when he's moving from Delhi to Yale University, studying design, and these are many of the images from his scrapbook. And since he decided that he wanted to put a lot of these photo collages on a background which has the Cellar logo. Cellar was one of the early discotheques in Delhi. And so then I decided that we would actually use this like a refrain. So at the center, you have Ram Rahman's photo collages on the Cellar logo, which we got a few spray paint, artists from Goa to spray paint the Cellar logo. And then I sort of repeated that for even Neil Chattopadhyay. And we have the archival material on this. And so here you have, through this exhibition, you have these prehistories of new media art from the 40s to the 80s. And the exhibition celebrated these often underdocumented alternative histories of being, doing, and making together, as I said, in photography, film, music, and transmedia experiments. It unfolded in a transdisciplinary and transcultural manner, including a dialogue between P. Mansaram and McLuhan, Geeta Sarabhai, and John Cage. The reason why I speak of wrong places is because the dominant art historical account has until recently perceived work made at trade fairs and expos as something that is tainted by commerce and entertainment. Thus, Krishan Khanna's massive photo murals, made in collaboration with the photographer Madan Mahata and shown at Expo 70 in Osaka, or Dashrath Patel's, sorry, I'm just going to... This is an image from Dashrath Patel's installation at the Montreal Fair, was seen as aberrations or mistakes rather than as experimental leaps. Whether it was Khanna and Patel's immersive installations, installations, I see these as precursors to installation art, which arrived on the Indian art scene only in the 1990s. I've been researching Krishan's extra-painterly practice over a long period. He made two immersive photo murals for Expo 70 in Osaka. One was commissioned by the MMTC, Minerals Trading Corporation of India, and the other by the Shipping Corporation of India. So MMTC is the first mural, and the one below it is the Shipping Corporation of India mural. And the commission for these murals was facilitated by Som Benegal, who was a multimedia specialist who had worked in radio, television, exhibition design, and print media since the early 40s. For these murals, Khanna transitioned from a solitary studio practice to collaborating with the eminent photographer Madan Mahata. They both visited the Bailadila site, which is rich in iron ore in Dantewada, Chhattisgarh, and took hundreds of photographs, which Khanna then projected on different surfaces and created a composite collage of multiple projections. The final result is dark and spectral, with glimpses of excavation machines and the lone Adivasi woman with a head load. This is clearly not a valorization of India's industrial advancement. The overexposed penumbral images neither allow us to see the present horizon in the photo collage nor the future. So the MMTC mural is the one below. Perhaps we needed a clearer image, but Even from this long shot, you can actually see that there are so many multiple projections on this image that you can't see the contours of any excavation machine properly. What you have basically are just layers and layers of images, one on top of the other. And in the main, it's an abstract photo mural. On occasion, you will find birds. You will find a member of the Adivasi community. You'll find one of these tankers with a faint Jawaharlal Nehru written on it. So these were images that were abstracted from a documentation of Bailadila. And above, what you have is the shipping mural. And the shipping mural, again, is very interesting, because here you have this tanker, which I was talking about, with Jawaharlal Nehru written on it, on the right corner of the MMTC mural. And they rotated this particular tanker under an enlarger, Madan and Krishan. And what they've created is a mandala-like image. And then you have one of the tankers actually, suddenly stepping out from this mandala. So it's only when you really go close that you realize it is a tanker. So again, the forms of abstraction that are being used. On the one hand, I mean, you know that this is, I mean, there's a national mandate that that Krishan Khanna has to has to speak to. But on the other hand, he takes these commissions and then transforms them, in a manner which is also quite inexplicable, because you just think, so he is supposed to show these murals, and these were large 10 feet murals. I mean, here we have a reproduction which is much smaller to go with the space. So you have these large immersive murals, and in the main, you really don't find any particular detail within it, which is documenting industrial progress in India. And I found that this was a very interesting strategy by the artist, because what he's doing is that he's using abstraction to subvert the nationalist agenda. So he's not just merely repeating, whatever he's expected to do, which is to glorify the nation, because this is after all a fair, and this is the Osaka Fair, one of the early trade fairs in Asia. And the idea is that each country competes with the other during the Cold War period to show that they are better than the other as far as industrial progress goes. So in such a situation, we have Krishan Khanna, who uses the strategy, the language of abstraction, to say something completely different, which is to use images which emerge from an uncertain past into an uncertain future. And the waves were then painted by Krishan. So they made this composite collage, and then he painted the waves, and then they took yet another image to create a composite mural. And I remember first seeing there is no original mural, because these are anyways photographs, but I saw these silver gelatin murals prints at his studio for the first time, and I remember they were absolutely fascinating when I actually looked at them, and then one could actually trace how just before he started doing these photo murals, he was working for himself in his studio and making composite photographs, again, which were based on multiple projections. So on the one hand, he had a studio practice, which was a private practice. And then on the other hand, he was also extending his practice to work in areas which were completely outside of the white cube. And what you find on the right-hand side are images from the Indian pavilion, but also from the American pavilion and other European pavilions at Osaka. So those are Madan Mahata images. Again, there were hundreds of them. So I edited them and turned it into a video loop. So what you actually also see is, how the pavilion looked at that time. And when I asked Jasbir Sachdev, who had designed the pavilion, whether Ritain's works were also shown at Expo 70, so he at that time said he wasn't very sure, he couldn't remember. But when you look at the images, then you realize that there are definitely works that definitely look like Ritain Majumdar in the images. But he wasn't sure, and he said that I only started working with Ritain Majumdar after Osaka. That's what he told me. So of course there are many different versions, and we have to keep checking depending on the evidence, because also memory fails us. So this is Jasbir Sachdev, a wonderful, wonderful person who I met in Delhi at his home. And by the time I met him in 2019, his wife had passed away. Is there something wrong with the images? This is Jasbir Sachdev against one of Ritain Majumdar's wall hangings. And this is Rosemary Sachdev, who had just passed away a week before I met Jasbir. So Rosemary Eagleston and Jasbir Sachdev. And you might just think, so why do I constantly bring in a new cast of characters? But the reason why I also do this, as I was saying earlier, is so that then you do not create a one-pointed history. Because my problem is that when we start retrieving lost histories and start glorifying one figure or one moment over another, we are creating new dogmas. Because just as much as we are fighting against old dogmas, we should not end up creating new dogmas of art history. So each time, let's say there's Krishan Khanna, whose mainstream art practice we're very familiar with. But then I decide to look at what is not his mainstream art practice, his work in photography. So he had, of course, had an exhibition of his photographs, the ones that he took in his studio. But after that, there wasn't much appreciation or any kind of critical acclaim for that work. And then that particular aspect of his practice petered out. It's what I'd called in one of my earlier essays, no context media, because these were people, whether it was Akbar Pratham Sen's films or Krishan Khanna's photo murals or photographs, they were working at a time when there was no critical apparatus to understand their work. So while art practice was ahead of art criticism, so therefore, you know, I mean, when certain experimental leaps were made, they were recorded, of course, and of course our gallerists were very supportive, and you know, I mean, you know, the Akbar Pratham Sen's films were definitely shown with the help of Pandol Art Gallery. Again, Krishan Khanna's photographs were also shown at a Delhi Art Gallery, and yet because there wasn't enough of a critical mass, these particular moments were forgotten, and also the artists could not pursue them. So we have Jasbir Sachdev here, you know, sitting against the Ritin Majumdar wall hanging. And as I started talking to him about the design that he had actually conceived, he and Rosemary had conceived for the Indian pavilion at Osaka, he told me that almost all the architects in the country competed for the design of the Indian pavilion in Osaka. There were some 110 models and drawings, and they selected our work. Rosemary and I felt really lucky, close quote. The minimal design for the pavilion, a folded conical structure, which depending on your vantage point, looks like either a mountain or a mound, but also a Mobius strip. It emerged in a flash on Jasbir's mind screen. So, I mean, when I asked him, so how did it happen? And he said that, you know, he was attending a seminar and he was quite bored, and he made the sketch on a four square cigarette box. And then he and Rosemary made a small model in plasticine. So this, and that's how you have this design drawn up for the pavilion. And the elliptical cone split on top, of course, allows the light to filter in, but the split could also be interpreted as a schism caused by the partition, reminding us that the birth of the new nation was accompanied by a bloodbath. So what we also have in the Indian Indian pavilion at Osaka, where you had Ritin Majumdar's wall hangings, you had Krishan Khanna's photo murals, you also have, I mean, in Madan Mata's archive, I found a slide of, you know, I mean, of people working on the pavilion, and there was this slide of three women working on a floor plan, and they turned out to be Zehra Tayyabji, Radha Raina, and Ratna Fabri. Women exhibition designers and crafts activists contributed significantly to the expo exhibitions. Sachdev praised Fabri's efforts to produce innovative interiors, experimenting with local materials and formats. The Sachdevs also worked with the textile designer Ritin Majumdar on various trade fairs. In a recent photograph of Sachdev resting in his home in Kailash Colony in Delhi, you see Majumdar's tapestry in the background. The histories of exhibition design and textile design are absent from the mainstream art historical discourse. CCCC makes a modest effort to correct this lacuna. Although Jasbir, as I said, couldn't recall whether Ritain had contributed or not, you know, certain artworks to the Expo 70, some of the photographs do show, even though they are completely faded and faint, you know, I mean, works that seem to belong to Ritain Majumdar. But for the next two decades and after the 70s until the late 80s, Ritain Majumdar worked with Sachdev Eagleston Associates on several projects. And there are two projects which stand out for their ambition, scale, and ingenious innovation. So I'll just elaborate a little bit on what Ushmita has shown you. She's shown you some of the images, and I'd just like to elaborate a little bit on that, and then I will close. So the first one being, this is a detail. Of course, as Ushmita was saying, you know, for him it was not so much about the religious, the religious import of the text or of the script. In this particular tapestry, if you actually look below, while on the one hand you have the ancient seal like mandala, but where you have actually the running script below, that script actually says Bhajo Radhe Govind, which is a Vaishnav chant. Now that is not that is not indecipherable. That is very clear. So I think again, you know, I mean, this is something that we can take up during the discussion, you know, because I mean the relationship of, you know, I mean, of artists to religion in a Nehruvian socialist republic, you know. And again, it's complex because on the one hand you have the intentionality of the artist, where the artist says this has nothing to do with anything religious, and of course I would also agree, because you know, if you see a mandala, it could be Gottlieb, you know, and or it could just simply be an archetypal image, you know, which could resonate with everybody, even those who have not seen Gottlieb, you know. So yes, there are many ways in which we could interpret this, and we can take that up later. But to move on to two of the important exhibitions to which he had Ritin Majumdar had contributed works. So you have this, the first one is where you have these monumental mobiles in wood, iron, plastic, and paint that which he made for the Engineering Trade Fair in 1975. And this trade fair was at the Hall of Nations, the permanent fairgrounds in Pragati Maidan in Delhi. Although the Hall of Nations was a great technical achievement in its own time, and we all know its history. Unfortunately, we know its history much more today precisely because it was destroyed. We only look back at history when we realize that something has been destroyed or history is in crisis. We never take measures before that to conserve things. So the Hall of Nations, of course, was a great technological marvel. But on the other hand, and this is what Ritin Majumdar says in a conversation in a feature in the Design magazine, he said that the shell inside this Hall of Nations had very high ceilings. And then the exhibitors' stalls were very tiny because they would not go up to whatever 20 feet, right? They would be your 8 or 10 feet, exhibition wall size. So you, as you can even see in this picture, you have these very tiny exhibitors' stall, and then you have these extremely high ceilings. So then what happens to the space between the ceiling and the floor level? And the exhibitors' stalls all get dwarfed. So that's when Majumdar thought that, okay, what can I do to remedy this? And that's when he thought about making these monumental mobiles. And they are not just flat surfaces, they are also moving. So they're three-dimensional and they're colored. And they could also remind us of Calder's mobiles as well, you know. So I was just doing research, and sorry, and I just thought I'll quote a little bit from the Design magazine also for you to give you a sense of why certain decisions, artistic decisions, are made. So that's how we conceived of an idea of bridging the cavernous space between the ceiling and the exhibition area. And of course, on this, he worked with Onkar Singh, the structural engineer's help. And it was a mammoth operation with winches and pulleys. And the mobiles were hung 90 feet above these exhibitors' walls. And the article specially acknowledges Sachdev and Eagleston for facilitating the concept. They supported Ritin Majumdar. So again, I'm showing you how these were all people who worked like constellations. You know, I mean, they worked in dialogue and in friendship. They supported each other. If Ritin Majumdar did not have Onkar Singh, he would never have executed these monumental mobiles. If Eagleston and Sachdev had not supported this idea, because since they were the ones who were commissioning him as architects, these monumental mobiles would never have happened. And very briefly, the other project was a mural for Bhel, Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, which was a pavilion for the third Asian Fair in 1972. And this is again very interesting because in one of these articles in the Design magazine, I was just reading up and about Bhel. And here again, the idea was that the interiors of this particular pavilion was not very exciting. So then they decided that instead of trying to enhance the interiors, why not use the exterior itself and turn it into an artwork? So the space frame, this triangular steel space frame, then that itself becomes an artwork with this kind of plastic sheathing. It is a translucent surface, so you can both look inside and outside. So you're blurring the inside and the outside. And then you have Majumdar painting, you know, his womb-like images, womb, mandala on it. And then they had this lighting choreography, which sort of would dim and illuminate this whole pavilion. So again, all these various experimental decisions which were made, which enhanced the viewer's experience. And Anise Jung, in her essay in Design Magazine 1973, while talking about the pavilions in Asia, Asia 72, of course, Bhel was only one of the pavilions amongst many others, asked a very significant question. Does Asia 72 represent an aesthetic hodgepodge or reveal a nation's generic diversity? And she described Bhel, this pavilion, as a delicately beautiful pavilion and an example of creative architecture. And of course, then I was going to go into Dashrath Patel and many other narratives, but I'm not going to do so. maybe another a separate lecture on CCC, but I feel very happy to have shared some of these thoughts and in a way further annotated what Ushmita is saying, and then Mayank will take the narrative even further. So thank you so much.